How you doing? I thought about doing this as a series of pictures with written words on instructions how to do things, but that just seemed like a lot more work than doing a quick tutorial video here. So, the question was, how do you set up a game on Roll20 and use it for the One Ring second edition and have elements there that are useful for your players as well as for the GM. So here we go. First of all, how to create the game itself. When you create the game, you're gonna click on the button. You're gonna go down here to choose sheet, and it is under. You scroll down until you get to T's. There are S. The One Ring. Here it is. And you're going to use the One Ring set 2E Advanced, and it's going to come up with a character sheet that was created by Oboto or something like that. I can't remember his name here on our Discord server. Anyway, and then name it. Whatever you name your game, and click I'm ready, create game. And that will create the game with character sheets with that format so that your players have them. Real simple. All right, so with that being said, I'm going to cancel this because I don't need that. So we're going to go in here into the Ruins of the North, which is my game. And I'll show you what I've got here to help players. So, first thing is, one of the questions was, how do you monitor eye and eye awareness? How do you monitor hope points or fellowship points? And I use these two tokens here. This is my eye awareness token, and this is my hope token. You can get these off of the internet. Most places might have to turn them into PNGs, use a resource on the internet to make them transparent. But you can see here that when I mouse over the eye awareness, it says 11 of 20. So my heroes have accrued 11 eyes on feet die over this adventure phase, or at least since the last revelation. And that's how you track it. That's how I track it there. So it's real simple. You create a token and then you set the bars to what you want them to be. I use bar 3, 11 of 20. I also create over here on my character sheets. I created an actual character sheet for eye awareness and fellowship points. It's blank. I use endurance, 11 of 20. Okay, so I set endurance to 20, which is the maximum that the eye can go to. And then, of course, what the current endurance is what my current eye awareness is. So that character sheet then has this icon as its token. Okay, so when you look at it, and then I typed all this stuff in here to monitor how the eye awareness is computed, what the starting eye awareness is after a revelation based on character heroes, weapons, and then of course your thresholds based on where they are, what part of the world they're in, and if there's any modifiers due to patrons or anything like that. So that's for me as a GM. Players can see it too if they want to, but that's for me. The GM notes down here is where I list things that make up these scores. But the character sheet itself is left empty except for, like I said, I just used the endurance current and max. So when you drag the character over onto the sheet, boom, your eye awareness is there. There are functions in the icon setup that you can have a nameplate. And I changed the nameplate to Eye Awareness. You do these drop downs here and you mark them C so the players can see it. And then as the eye awareness goes up or down, you can just go to the sheet and you go, oh, someone just rolled an eye, plus one. So now the eye awareness is 12. And if you mouse over it, it says eye awareness 12 of 20. And they have an idea as far as range, as far as when they're going to potentially have a threat. If they go to the resource character under the resource actual eye awareness character sheet, they'll see, like I said, under the bio, they can see what their thresholds are based on what type of terrain or lands they're in, which truthfully is GM knowledge more so than players what they know. Same thing is for the fellowship. I created a character sheet, uses the endurance 6 of 6. You could use the hope bar, you can use the hopes, whatever you want to use, doesn't matter. You just need one of these strength, or one of the, either endurance or hope, and it does the same thing. So I mouse over, and let's get rid of that a second, let's drag it on here. This needs to be fixed. Yeah, fellowship, that should be that. That is fine. Save settings. But I want the bar to be at the top. I think that's how I have them. Save changes. So again, let's delete. There it goes. So the fellowship now says fellowship. And it has the 6 of 6. So they have 6 of 6 fellowship points in their pool. As they use one, they can just, and the players can interact with this, so they can change it. So they use one, they say, I'm going to use a fellowship point. They reduce the fellowship pool, and that's how that works. So that's that was the first question. How do you what do you use to monitor or help the players track their resources? And that's the first thing I do. Okay, a lot of that is stuff you're gonna have to, I mean, there are other tutorials on the Roll20 wiki which will show you how to set up characters or set up things in the edit screen and all that kind of stuff, so that you're making sure your players can see and edit and all that kind of stuff. So that's that. Character sheets. Here's a character, Aradel. Player is able to control it. If we go to edit here, we're going to see that Aradel is controlled by the player named Aradel. That's what this is. The token that's placed, again, edit properties of the token. I have a nameplate, so every time you bring up the character sheet or the token on the screen, it'll when you mouse over it, it'll say Aradel. Cells here are determined as far as what you want them to track. I have them tracking endurance and hope. The third bar I don't care about. You want to make sure they can see them. And because they have the principal power of editing here on the first page, can edit by, you don't need to set up edits on the tokens. That automatically happens. So that is the character's token. And then everything about the character sheet is basically what you know from the books. There's really not much to get into this, other than to say if you needed to clear out, let's say you mistakenly put a pip in a skill and that was a mistake, you have to click this. Now there's a little icon here that'll erase it. And the thing is, it'll erase them all. So let's say you had 3 and you put, you meant to increase awareness, but you hit hunting by accident. If you click it, it'll delete all 4 of them. So you have to fill in what you might have actually, you know, make sure you've reconciled correctly for that stuff. Notes, clicking notes switches between special screens of showing, and these are self-assigned by the player. I kind of keep a consistency with all my character sheets for my players that blessings, refuges, and any patrons are listed on the first one. Rewards and virtues, if there's special things about the rewards and virtues beyond just being keen or grievous or whatever. And then equipment that might be special that I'm listing outside of this box up here. And in adventures and fellowships, I have them list every adventure phase that we do. what years it took place, what their undertakings were during the fellowship phases between them, and that's just kind of for our own character history. Everything else is self-explanatory as to just like the character sheets, filling them out. Little check marks means you're favored. You can favor Valor. That's great. When you go into combat, you will select your stance. And that's a great function that'll add the dice, remove the dice based on stance. Forward adds a dice, defensive subtracts a dice. There are functions in here that maybe the skill, something's favored, but it's not permanently favored because of mastery. So you can click favored here or ill favored. When your character's endurance reduces under their total of load and fatigue, the two numbers added together, plus treasure, if they carry treasure too, the weariness button will automatically populate. If you are hope goes under your shadow score, miserable will populate. If you're wounded, you'll click it. If you're daunted, you'll click it. Daunted is when a monster makes it so you can't spend hope in a round. Some undead do that. Another thing is when you take a wound, you click the wounded box. After you roll your feat die to determine how many days you'll be wounded, you type in here as far as the injury goes, how long that injury will last. That wounded box will stay until that injury counts down the number of days, and then the wounded box can be removed. As you know, if a character takes a second wound while they're wounded, they have only so long to live unless they receive medical aid. So that's the character sheet, and that will be in the available when you add character. So when you go here and you add, click a character, it'll bring up that sheet because that's the sheet that you assigned to your game. So that's simple. I do add journals for the players. The picture element I put in here, it's real simple, but I make it so that the player can edit it. As you can see here, all players can read it, but Roki can edit it, and they're able to write their songs and do their things. Kind of a neat little easy way for them to create a journal for their characters in terms of their creative, you know, this particular journal is much more full with songs that the elf wrote. And it's great. I award XP for characters and players that are more involved. I set up a separate folder for items as they find special items and they are theirs. I set up a special folder for NPCs that they might run into along the way. These can have a character sheet like this, or they can just be a description. The Hunter and the Beast. Lastly, of course, I have quick rules for the players so that they can quickly see how the rules work in the game. This is something that I generated as images for my players. It's not something that is part of Roll20. You have to add them yourself if you want to do that. I create locations for my players as histories. I create geographies so if they go to a certain land, they will know what that land is like. Again, this is on you. This isn't automatic. Locations, the same thing. So if they go to Barad Eldenar, which is a place in our game, tells them the information about that place. I usually open these up as they discover them. Otherwise, that stuff remains hidden in this folder called Unrevealed. I add a lot of history for my games so that the players can, and for those that are strong with Tolkien's lore, those that are not necessarily strong with Tolkien's lore, they have an idea of what went on before them. And, some of this stuff might require lore rolls, but it is for player purpose so that they can immerse themselves in the genre and the history of Lord of the Rings, all the way back to the Silmarillion. So those are the assets I create for the players. I also have assets here for me as lore master. This is GM information. This is stuff that's purely my information. Right now they're moving through the ruins of Fornost. So these things are my notes on the throne room of Arvedui and such. I have all of my enemies created in that character sheet that you saw that I populated the game room with the token is got an option. So when you create a character, it's going to ask you, let's see here, let's just say changes, the sheet comes up, it's going to ask you whether you want a player character, an adversary, and the release log just talks about the what all the changes the in the form. But you click adversary and it comes up with the adversary information. So when we go down here to adversaries, we can pick up the Orc Guard Great, and the bio info gives you the token that I use for him, and this is the information either from the book or creatures that I create myself, using some of the monsters in the book already as templates, and to stay consistent using the special fallibilities that each of them have. I was a big Tor first edition player, so I have all of the books from that, and so things like Nazgul and the Witch King and all these things I have from the first edition that I've translated over to second edition. So these things, again, are things you got to create for yourself. It takes time, but you know what you're going to be doing in a given session. You know what they're going to potentially face. So I just work on those pieces as they're needed, not everything at once, obviously. I add new beasts and drakes and things to my game as I know the potential for the characters or the players to run into them approaches. So that's everything in terms of how to use the resources. There's the dialogue box. This is where the dice roll will come from the character sheets. So when a character clicks a protection roll, as you can see here, it will automatically know its target number based on, well, no, you enter the target number in the dialogue box. Well, why don't I just show you that real quick? So this is part of this video. So Aridel, she first of all, let's say she's going to make an attack roll. So she takes a great bow and she fires. So the first thing is, are there any bonus dice beyond her stance? She's in forward right now because she's in a bow. She should be in rearward. But for all intents and purposes, we can see that this is automatically populated with 1D because of forward stance. So we would submit, we would put in the target's parry number. So the monster has, let's say it has a 2 armor parry, or 2 parry. We put a 2 there, and the result then is Aridel fires her great bow. She has a target number of 17 based on her strength, plus 2. She rolls a 23. It's a piercing blow with her keen fell bow. She does 4 damage, and the enemy now has to make a 18 injury roll against the strength of the bow there. Cool thing is, it was ill-favored as well. For some reason, she's marked ill-favored. I think we were tweaking with those buttons. And you'll see that the dice roll was a 9 and actually a Gandalf rune would have come up there on that 12. So it would have been an automatic success or the success. This side shows the success dice. There were no 6s in there, so there were no bonus successes for additional damage or piercing or any kind of functions that the success dice can offer players. But that's how dice work on skills and protection rolls, whatever it might be. You're going to see any skill has this little D12-sided looking thing here next to it. That's how you roll them. So you click a protection test. You're going to put in the injury rating. Let's say it's 16. That's what the injury rating of the enemy's weapon is when she's rolling a protection test against it. And she submits. There's no bonus dice unless, let's say, no, she goes, I'm going to spend a hope point. So we throw in a hope point, and boom, she rolls a 15 out of 16, which is a failure, and she takes a wound. The player then needs to go over to their character sheet and click wounded. Okay, they're also going to roll the feat dice. You can do a couple things here. You can do a switch R 1d12. Which will roll the d12, and look at that, they roll Gandalf, so they're not wounded. If you know the game, you know that a 12 on the dice is a Gandalf. I set up macros too for dice that you can use, that I use here. You'd have to set these up yourself if you want to use them. You do it in your own game, obviously. So let's say this is a wound. You should just want to find out what the... So input value is nothing more than what's going to be the header on the thing there. And there's no target number because this is just to determine how many days of a wound she's got. We don't have any success dice in there. So it rolls a 2 on the feet die. You with me? That's all that I'm... And that's for the wounded thing, the status, just to be able to roll a dice by itself. You can do it via the one, you know, slash or forward slash R, or you can set up macros like I have to roll dice and then it does this, or you use the built-in dice roller on the character sheet, which is cool. You can do that over here by filling in this custom die roller. Wound test, feet die normal, no success die, and then click the button, and boom, again, we get a Gandalf room. The Gandalfs are falling, that's awesome. So, anyway, that's how the dice rolling works in the game. You might know this from already playing Roll20, so maybe I'm talking too much here. This is a section for pictures for GMs, for you to load in your pictures that you want to use. I have multiple different games. They list your pictures, or all your pictures are always listed no matter what game you go into. So I take the time to make subfolders in my folders to make sure that I'm putting my tokens how I want them. Tokens I generally make myself from pictures I find on the internet, but there are pre-made tokens out there that people make that you might be able to tap into. This is again the character. So you got your dialogue box between the players. This is where we chat. This is where we roll. Dice rolls show up. This is for the GM. This is purely for the GM. This is their storage of pictures. This is the player journal or GM journals. Both GMs and players will work within the journals. Here's where your character sheets and all anything the lore master or game master wants to create for their game. This is where you can control your music. I've uploaded blurbs of the movies music for my games. And finally, as I said, you can create macros. That's what these things are down here. If you are experienced with macros, I'm not going to get into it with this video, but you create a macro and then you put it in bar and it allows you to click this button. Brings up a dialogue box, a series of dialogue boxes based on your macro to roll a special kind of die. Then you can add your dice, actually the type of dice you want. Like here's my normal success dice, here are my weary success dice with the faded 1, 2, 3 and so on. Again, if that's information you need, I'll make a separate video because that is going to get long. An understanding. So that's that. Lastly, okay, so how do we do the journey log? This is my journey log. I create this as a separate sheet. This is a map that I've drawn. It is actually layered. It's got the map of Rudaur and Arnor underneath it. Then I've layered over a hex grid, and then I've layered on top of that a template that I created for the travel log. These things are editable. Change it to 2956 or 2955 as it is. Summer, where from, where to, how many days is expected. If there's any kind of weariness earned, I've set these boxes up that I click them and I send them to the token layer, and that way the players then can see them. Right now they're on the GM layer. Players can't see them until I send them to the token layer. So that way they can know they've earned a fatigue point or travel fatigue. At the end of the travel journey, they can roll against removing some of that travel fatigue, as you know. Someone created this mat out there. It's on the internet somewhere. I think it's on our Discord, One Ring Discord. I've made this part of my journey log so the players can place their tokens as they wish as far as what role they're in, and they know how to manage the journey themselves with the instructions and the results on this mat. So simple to use, take some time as GM to create and set up. Again, that's, you gotta spend some time to build this stuff. I have the primary map for the players as far as our game goes, the area door map, and their travel. Okay, so everywhere they've been, I number on the map. That number then correlates to a part of our locations, 1 through 19, that we've experienced and been to. So they can go, what was 17 Dolgormain? And they can bring up the information about Dolgormain that they want as they open them. Again, this stuff is revealed as they go. As you can see, the Eye Awareness and the Fellowship are here on every map. Everything I set up, I make sure the Eye Awarenesses are there, as well as the Fellowship things. And there is a company token that they move around when they travel. They can move this. Right now they're in Forest. They do have their own tokens, and these are for more so for battle maps. I have created icons so that when they're in forward stance, when they're in open, when they're in defensive, and when they're in rearward. And I also include skirmish from solo in this as a function in our game, because there are times that enemies approach archers and can attack, and I use the skirmish rule. So that's that. And the map is the map. Okay, continuing on here. And then we get into the actual maps that they might go to. So as they are exploring Fornos, they will be coming to this map next. This is the Hall of Arendir. Arendir, however it's pronounced there. The players are able to move their tokens. Their tokens show their current endurance, their current hope, and we use this as tactical maps too. I use forward and all that stuff, but still I use elements of tactical. I don't do theater of the mind stuff with our combat, even though Tor is set up for that. I still use tactical maps and use the functions of Tor as in terms of tactical combat, because it works. And that's pretty much everything. I think that hits on the questions that were asked. Hopefully this video is small enough that I can upload it. If not, then maybe I'll have to make another, or maybe I'll put it on YouTube and direct you guys to it. This also, you know, as you can see, is my, here's on the GM level, I have all my enemies that will potentially threaten the players when they come into this chamber. They'll go from this chamber into the throne room of Arvidui, and potentially meet Gishak Yishnaga, which is the whole part of this particular adventure here. And some stuff I create with pieces, parts that I have purchased within Roll20 to generate these kind of dungeons and underground things. So again, a lot of it comes down to a lot of lore master preparation. I made this map for Fornos. It's an old MERP map, but I edited it and I cleaned it up and I added different things to it so that it looked like more of a ruin. And you know, it takes time, but it's worth it for my players. Enjoy it, and I enjoy the act, you know, I enjoy making it so that they have a great game session. And so Roll20 can work really great for Tor. I've heard that Foundry is the only way to go, or the best way to go. And I'm not going to discount that the system isn't, because it's built primarily, and there's modules built primarily for that VTT. But Roll20 is great because I don't have to host. I don't have to be the server. Roll20 is the server. Everybody just goes to Roll20 and they can log into my game. It just takes a little bit more effort on my part as GM to create the functions that we need in the game. If you're the kind of GM that doesn't mind doing that stuff, then you'll have no problem using Roll20 as your virtual tabletop for playing the One Ring. If you have any questions, shoot me a question in the Discord server or in the YouTube thing, wherever I've posted this. So, thank you for your time. Hope this helped.